So here in this passage, we find Jesus in a garden that is called Gethsemane. Have any of you been to Israel and seen what is purported to be the Garden of Gethsemane? Raise your hand if you have. Sven has, and one in the back. Okay, so a couple of you folks have at least seen the garden that is purported to be the place where this scene transpired. Here's a photo of it for those of us who haven't been there. Beautiful place. Beautiful place. So even if this isn't the actual Garden of Gethsemane from the time of Christ, it gives you an idea of what it probably would have looked like. But this is the place purported to be that garden. Now, do you know what Gethsemane means? It means oil press. Now, here's a photo of an oil press. Next one. Now, obviously, the oil that is in view in naming a place Gethsemane would have been olive oil. And said olive oil press would have been on, where else? The Mount of Olives, where there have historically been groves of olives. And olive oil was pressed and used for all sorts of things in the biblical world. Okay? So this is where we find Jesus. He has probably gone out, well, not probably gone, he has gone out from the Passover meal, which is concluded in a place where he observed it with his disciples. That meal having been observed and ended, they left late at night. They left the city of Jerusalem. They went down through the Kidron Valley and up the ascent of the Mount of Olives. Presumably Jesus is seeking a place of quiet and peace where we will collect his thoughts and fellowship with his Father and his disciples in these hours that remain before the great burden sets in, that which we know as his passion, the great suffering of Christ. And we see that even now the suffering is beginning, because here when we find Jesus in this garden suffering greatly, and yet it's not a physical suffering at this point. Now, does anybody in this room remember another occasion that we've already seen in the Gospel of Mark where Jesus and Peter, James, and John were together on the top of a mountain? Do you recall what that scene was in the Gospel of Mark? The Mount of Transfiguration. Probably not the same mountain, but nonetheless, the same people on the top of a mountain. And what happened there on the Mount of Transfiguration? Tell me if you remember. Moses and Elijah, who had been dead for hundreds of years, at least it seems to us, okay, are seen there by Peter, James, and John having a discussion with Jesus, who looks like what? He is transfigured. And he's white as lightning. And they are dumbfounded. They are amazed at what they are seeing. And they're being allowed to see a glimpse of Jesus, perhaps in the glory which he had with his Father before the world was made, and is somewhat veiled as he walks among us in human flesh. Well, they got a glimpse of this. But now here we find the same group of men, Peter, James, and John, beholding something else about Jesus on the top of a mountain. And it's not glory. It's great suffering. And I would submit to you, they're getting a glimpse of the very pain of God in this moment. And it's hard for us to imagine the pain of God, but this is what it looks like. And it's fitting for me that this scene plays out in a garden called Gethsemane, which means oil press, as Jesus himself seems to be rung on the oil press of suffering. So Jesus and his disciples have observed Passover. They're now on the Mount of Olives. We are told that as Jesus enters the garden, he says to the largest part of the group, which would have been eight of them, since three of them go with Jesus, one of them is not with them, and we know his name is Judas. He's already gone to lead a group of temple guards to come and take Jesus captive, so he's not present at the moment, which leaves eight. So Jesus leaves eight of the disciples, presumably around the entrance of this garden that he has used probably from time to time for such things. And he takes three of them, Peter, James, and John, with him further into the garden. Now, it's almost as if Jesus wants these three disciples, Peter, James, and John, who have also seen his glory on another mountaintop, to witness the suffering. It's almost like there's another transfiguration here that they're going to see, but it's of an opposite kind. It's great suffering. And I asked myself, does Jesus really have a purpose for these men to see him suffer in this way? Did he invite Peter, James, and John along so that they would witness his suffering in this way? That's one of the questions I've been asking myself all week. And if he did, why? What did Jesus want for those disciples in witnessing his suffering? I asked myself, was this for his benefit? You know how a lot of times when you're suffering, you want human companionship. You want somebody that's enfleshed who can join you and commiserate with you in the suffering. And I wondered, okay, is this for Jesus' benefit that he takes Peter, James, and John along? Or is it for Peter and James and John's benefit in some way? And how would they benefit from it? One thing I do know, and I can't answer all these questions, I'm throwing them out to you just to see like where my mind goes when I read these things, and it's helpful to ask these kinds of questions. I think it's good to ask these kinds of questions. One thing I can say for sure is that what you have here is an eyewitness account. How else would we know about it? You know that when you're reading Mark's gospel, you are reading whose account? Peter's eyewitness account of things, as recorded by his secretary, if you will, Mark. So Peter is one of the guys who is witnessing what you're seeing described here. And he's telling you about what he saw happen with Jesus on the Mount of Olives this night, hours before, even moments before, he is handed over to be crucified. Verses 33 through 34 say this: he took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. Now look at those words. Those are not chosen haphazardly. Deeply distressed and troubled. Now look what Jesus actually says. He says, my soul is what? With what? Overwhelmed with sorrow. How? To the point of, have you ever been so overwhelmed with sorrow that you thought you might expire? That's almost unimaginable. Stay here and keep watch, he told them. Now, I will be honest with you. A lot of people I've seen over the years struggle with what's happening in this passage. It's hard for us to wrap our heads around certain things that we know to be true about Jesus and yet allow for him to be struggling in certain ways that we assume he is struggling. For instance, if we see in Jesus in other places in the gospel where he seems to know stuff that ordinary people shouldn't know, you know, an omniscience, if you will, how in the world then can he be suffering like he is? If he has such a faith in his Father that is so exemplary for us, that is a perfect trust in his Father, how can he be suffering so? Those are the questions sometimes I think people struggle with when they witness this scene. What is he struggling with? And why and how, if these things are true of Jesus? I remember when I was in my 20s, one Bible teacher that I worked with struggling with this passage to the point where he would hear discussion of what's going on in this passage, and he would always come to Jesus' defense. And I remember his words vividly. He said, Jesus never balked at the cross. As though he is balking at the idea of his death on a cross here, just because he's suffering in a garden. And it seems to me that our struggle sort of discloses what I will call an inability to allow for Jesus to be really and fully human. Sometimes we will camp so much on the divine part of Jesus that we struggle to allow true humanity to come through in Jesus. You know, like having real human emotion. Well, maybe Jesus' emotion was somewhat diminished as a human because he's also divine. Why do we do that? Why do we have to go there? We struggle with allowing Jesus to feel the toil that great burdens and great pressures take upon human beings. And I was reminded, of course, of a passage that most people go to, or a lot of people will go to when you think about this. It's found in Hebrews, and the passage tells us this about Jesus. We do not have a high priest who's unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but what does that imply? Well, we do have a high priest then who is able to empathize with our weaknesses. Why? He goes on to explain to us. We have one who's been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. So clearly in the Garden of Gethsemane this night, we find Jesus locked in some sort of a struggle. He clearly feels immense burden and heavy, heavy sorrow. But here's the point. To feel immense burden and heavy, heavy sorrow is not sin. Sometimes you feel like that may be wrong for you. Did Jesus feel it? You haven't even tasted the likes of what Jesus tasted in the garden that night. So you cannot conclude that it is sin to feel those things. Now, for me, a look at some of the words is helpful. I want to point out to you two words that Mark uses here in his original writing here that might be helpful in giving you insight here. The first one is ekthambeste, which means to throw into amazement or terror. Okay, this is the word that we translate as thrown into deep distress. Okay, Jesus became deeply distressed. Okay, it's a word that means to throw out of one state quickly and into another. What's interesting about it is it sometimes is used into being thrown into amazement, like something good and astonishingly great that happens, and you're just elated. But it's also used, like in this case, the other direction. Something takes you from one state and draws you into great distress. Well, this is what word Mark chose to use for Jesus here. And it's interesting that the prefix there, the ek part is a word that means out. So ekbalo means to throw out, okay? So Jesus is thrown out of one state and into another here. That's the word that Mark uses, okay? Now, the other word that Mark uses right on the tails of this is this word ademonein, which means distressed, troubled. He was thrown out of one state and thrown into great distress, overwhelmed with deep suffering, you could say. Now, frankly, I don't like, and most of us don't like to think of Jesus as being deeply distressed and troubled. We would rather look away from that. We would rather ignore that. But I think we must look it in the face, because this is what is described for us. Now listen to Jesus' own words as he describes how he is feeling. Jesus actually describes how he was feeling. Here's how it is put, verses 34 and 35. He says, and this is a quote, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death." Now look a little further in the verse, down to verse 35. Going a little further, "He fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him." Now that is serious, heavy-duty distress. I don't know if any burden has ever thrown you to the ground in prayer. Maybe you've been there. Jesus was there. The word that's translated as overwhelmed is this perilupos word, and it's a compound word. Compound words are fascinating to me when you look at them in the original language. The first part is peri. Now, any of you in a medical field knows about the pericardium, right? That part surrounding the heart, okay? The pericardium is that which surrounds the heart or encases or enwraps one's heart, okay? A perimenopausal is that which is around menopause, okay, peri. So you see what peri means. It's that which surrounds or engulfs, okay? And the lupos word is just simply pain. So Jesus says of himself, he is completely subsumed, engulfed in pain. Even to the point of death, he says. Now, do you think of Jesus as a man who chose his words haphazardly? Yeah, no. Well, these words come out of his lips, even to the point of death. I think of Jesus as a man who said what he meant and meant what he said. And I think you do too. So I don't think he's just exaggerating for effect. This is what he is feeling. Now, it's clear that Jesus is suffering here in the garden, but what's not as clear is the reason for the suffering. Some people surmise, well, maybe it's dread of impending physical torture, which you know is moments away, hours away. Some people surmise maybe it's a sense of abandonment and loneliness. Some people surmise, well, maybe it's the dread of being, quote, forsaken by his father as he dies on the cross, whatever that means. There is admittedly a mystery here. that I can't solve and that you can't solve, and unless we like to try to. There's a mystery that we cannot solve. Why? Because none of us has ever had the experience of being both divine and fully human at the same time. Jesus is unique in this way, and this is what the Bible describes about Jesus. He's fully divine and fully human. So since we've never had experience with that, we cannot understand the struggles that might go on as those things work themselves out together. How does that express itself? How do they interplay? We don't know. It's a mystery. But theologians love to write books about it. And they have for 2,000 years. And they'll keep on. As for me, I do not believe that it was the impending physical agony alone that was at the root of Jesus' suffering here, although I think that must have been part of it. How can you face physical agony and not be burdened by it in some way? I think that there was an inner emotional suffering of his soul as he faced what theologians like to call the cup of God's wrath, which is actually a phrase that Jesus uses. He talks about the cup and letting this cup pass. Well, the cup of God's wrath is an image used by Old Testament prophets in multiple places. And I think this is what Jesus speaks of as he talks about letting this cup pass, if possible. Now, let's camp here for a few minutes and observe a point that is so obvious that it's easy for it to escape. Suffering comes even to the godliest people. There it is. It's so obvious you might miss it. Suffering comes even to the godliest people. Look at Jesus in the garden. We watch him suffering here. And it should say to us, among other things, it's okay to suffer. It's part of the deal. Nothing unusual is going on here when I suffer. I'm not the only one to suffer. Jesus knows what it is like to suffer. And that truth by itself should give us grace to help us face our own suffering. But there's more. When I look closer at this scene, there's a theme that emerges for me. I wonder if you see it. It's the theme of aloneness. I see aloneness like blinking on and off like a neon sign. Aloneness. Oh, sure, Jesus has friends there. He's got people there. And no doubt, he desired their company. Remember he had said, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you. Well, that was just hours ago. He wants their company. He even takes them along into the garden. And yet, Jesus is totally aware of the fact that very soon they are going to abandon him. He has even told them so. You will all fall away because of me. He said just moments ago, on the way up the mountain. So they're there physically, but are they there for him? No, he knows that they will be scandalized by him in just a matter of moments, to the point where they will not even be able to confess before other people that they've ever met him. Boy, that will make you feel alone. And he knows where Judas is currently. He's going to round up a band of temple police and temple guards to come and take him as a prisoner. And he knows of the rejection of the official brass of Judaism. It's been rising for months, and he's been rejected. And so now, guys, here in the garden, we see that no one, even amongst his friends, has what I would call the ability, or shall we say the will, to enter into his struggle with him. What would you say? They don't have the ability, or they don't have the will to enter into the struggle with him? Which one of you could have understand what was going on with Jesus as he contemplates what's to transpire in the next hours? On a cosmic scale, could you understand it? Can you understand it this morning, even with hindsight? So Jesus is dealing with this, and he is alone. Guys, suffering has this tendency to make us feel very alone. And I believe that Jesus felt that. He had no one on earth who could understand the magnitude of what was going on there on a cosmic scale. That is, except for the Father in heaven and that is to whom we see Jesus go in this moment. But notice this, Jesus doesn't go to his Father in heaven as some last resort like we often do. He goes to his Father as to the source of his entire life. He goes to the Father as his all, his everything. Now, here's an important lesson for us, and it comes from the pen of Tim Keller in his book called Walking with God Through Pain and Suffering. Keller wrote, quote, "Suffering is unbearable if you are not certain that God is for you and with you." And I thought, how true of that, how true of Jesus is that in this moment as he turns to his Father? So Jesus is experiencing aloneness, especially as he anticipates the coming forsakenness, even of his Father, when he cries out on the cross, "Why hast thou forsaken me?" He's anticipating this, I believe, as he takes the sin of the world upon himself. There was a woman decades ago. Her name was Simone Veil. She was a French woman. She was a survivor of Auschwitz. She saw her entire family murdered at Auschwitz. She went on, and by the way, she's a French woman, she went on to become quite a cultural catalyst, a cultural agitator. She became a French politician. She has been greatly celebrated following her death as a very important person in the history of France. In her post-Auschwitz years, she wrote about things sort of as a philosopher. She wrote about things like suffering. Who would know suffering like an Auschwitz survivor would? Well, Simone Weil, she actually wrote about suffering and said, "Suffering almost immediately makes you feel cut off from the rest of the world, isolated even from your friends who you feel may not be able to really understand you anymore." I was wondering, have you ever had that experience? You've gone through some suffering and it has made you feel like even your friends cannot understand you anymore because of the suffering that you have been dealing with. And you felt very alone because nobody else seems to be able to enter into your suffering. Think of Jesus in the garden. Many people actually do pull away when you suffer because it reminds them of something that is uncomfortable. The fact that suffering can come upon any one of us, even them. And they do pull away because they don't know what to do with your suffering, which again contributes to your aloneness. Think about Jesus in the garden, as he's already announced that every one of them will be scandalized by him. He is going to become something that they will not want to admit they've ever had anything to do with. How does that feel? Not good. Now, here is a profound thought, at least for me. Jesus is alone this night, even though there are people around him. He knows he's alone, but get this, he is willing to go through absolute aloneness, even the aloneness of God's coming wrath, so that you would never have to endure it. That is amazing to me. This is not appropriate for him. It's not right for him. It's right for me. I deserve it. Jesus doesn't deserve it, but he's willing to go through it so that I will never have to face forsakenness by our Father in heaven. And so that you will never have to face absolute forsakenness by your Father in heaven. So Jesus takes it upon himself. Now notice this. I noticed this in the garden, is in his interactions with his disciples, Peter, James, and John. Jesus does not become embittered toward these guys who should, but can't even begin to enter into the suffering with him. All they can do is sleep. And he doesn't get bitter at them. Which reminds me of something else that Simone Weil talked about when she talked about suffering in her writings. She said that suffering understandably makes it very difficult to think of other people. When you suffer, you have no margin she says. No energy, no thought for anything but your own suffering. And over time, your trials can even lead you into a kind of pride, making you feel noble and superior to others who haven't gone through the same deep waters that you've gone through. Oh, guys, that is so true. That is so true. The problem of self-absorption. Now, here's what I noticed with Jesus in the garden. Jesus is the farthest thing in the world from self-absorption and pride as he suffers in the garden. He keeps coming back to Peter, James, and John and finds them asleep. And what is his recurrent refrain with them? It's basically this. You guys are in peril. You're weak. So watch. Pray, lest you be swallowed up in temptation. Your spirits, guys, are willing, but your flesh is so weak and you don't even know. Watch. You can't even understand this. Pray. That's not self-absorption. He's concerned about the well-being of these men who are very soon to say, I never even met him. This is extraordinary. Now I want to focus on something that is very beautiful, and very encouraging. It's the way Jesus relates to his Father now, the only one who can enter in to what Jesus is experiencing here. Look at verses 35 and 36. Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything's possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. Now, I think it's well known that Abba is an ancient Aramaic word that best translates into English as the word daddy. Daddy. That is an extremely intimate way to speak to God. Now, one thing I would like you to reflect upon is this. That level of intimate approach to God amongst Judaism of that day would have been thought blasphemously disrespectful. It would have made people extremely uncomfortable. And I don't know how much you know about Islam in the world today and the history of Islam, but in Islam, historically and even currently, this idea of being intimately loving with God and God loving you and allowing you to be this intimate with him, that is completely anathema. Islam does not know of a God of love that you could call daddy. And yet here is the way Jesus relates to his Father in heaven. Extraordinarily intimate. It was absolutely natural for Jesus, but it wasn't for others. Now here's the thought I want you to take away from this. The same intimacy with God is something to which Jesus is giving us access. Again, it's astonishing. Something unthinkable to the ancient Jew, something unthinkable even to a Muslim today. But listen to the Apostle Paul, as Paul talks about this very same thing. He wrote to Galatians who were living in, to Christians who were living in Galatia in the first century, and he said this: when the time had fully come, God sent his son, Jesus, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship. Because you are his sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts. The Spirit who calls out what? Abba, Father. Now, look at that again. Who's calling out Abba, Father? Look at it. What does it say? The Spirit of his Son, the Spirit of Jesus, in our hearts, calling out Abba, Father. So, he says, you are no longer a slave, but God's child. And since you are his child, God has also made you an heir. God has made you also an heir. So Jesus speaks to his Father and says, Abba, Father, take this cup from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. So Jesus here is not submitting to a God who makes cynical sport of human beings. That would have been the God of the Romans, one of the gods of the Romans or Greek mythology. Neither is Jesus submitting here to a God who's cold and distant and obscure like some ironclad fate. Jesus knows God as Daddy, Father. And you and I can too because of Jesus. As we wind up here, I want to tell you a story that I came across in my readings this week about a man whose name was Richard Cameron in the 1600s. He was Scottish. It's funny, I find more and more Scottish people who rise to the fore in stories of spiritual struggle and following God in difficulty. Richard Cameron was a Presbyterian living in Scotland in the 1600s. And at the time, there was great struggle for the purity of the church. And the state wanted to seize control of the Presbyterian church. And those folks, part of the church, some withstood that very strongly. They would not allow for the state to come in and take control of the church. They believed in the purity of the church. And Richard Cameron was one of those who resisted, and he was actually executed for his resistance to the attempts of the state to control the church. And get this is a different time, a little bit more barbaric. Well, it's not even a different time, it's just a different spot on the globe, because when he was killed, his head was removed and his hands were cut off, and they were taken to his father, who was in prison in Edinburgh at the time for the very same offense, resistance to the state's quest to take control of the Presbyterian church. Now think about the brutality of this. Think about the barbarianism of this. So those who represented the state take the head of Richard Cameron and the hands of Richard Cameron, who's been executed, and they present them in prison to Richard Cameron's father as a way of rubbing salt in a wound, if you will. It's an attempt to mock him and add grief unto his already sorrowful state. And they asked his father if he recognized them. Now I'm going to tell you how William Barclay relates the rest of the story. Barclay writes, "Taking his son's head and hands, he kissed them and said, 'I know them. I know them. They are my sons, my own dear sons.'" Now notice what he says. He says, "It is the Lord. Good is the will of the Lord, who cannot wrong me nor mine, but hath made goodness and mercy to follow us all our days." Now Barclay continues with his own comments here. He says, "If we can call God Father, everything becomes bearable. Time and again, we will not understand, but always we will be certain that the Father's hand will never cause his child a needless tear." That is what Jesus knew when he says, "Not my will, but thy will." That is why he could go on, and it can be so with you and me. "Abba, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass. But not my will, thy will." Now, guys, is that not the posture with which you and I must go through this life? Note the intimacy, the willingness and the ability to pray, "Daddy, can it be some other way? It hurts. But nevertheless, it's not what I want, it's what you want. I trust you." Is that not the way that he calls us to go through this life? The answer is yes. That's what we learn here. One final quote that I found this week that I thought was worth sharing, and it kind of goes off in a little bit different direction, and it comes from a source that's a little bit different. This is a theologian named Walter Brueggemann, and he wrote as he was grappling with what's going on here in Gethsemane. He wrote the following, and it's a great quote. He says, "In Jesus' prayer in Gethsemane, Jesus affirms that for you, Father, all things are possible. In the end, however, the one thing that is not possible is that an obedient Jesus should be rescued from suffering. In that suffering and death, faith reaches the edge of God's impossibility. Think about that one for the week. So as we conclude, what have we seen? Well, we have witnessed in Gethsemane the suffering of Jesus, which hopefully has given us some insight as to our own suffering and how we can face our own suffering. We've seen the incapacity of people to be there for us. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. We have also seen the spirit in which you and I should face life. The spirit that says, yet not what I will, but what you will. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this amazing passage, giving us a glimpse into the struggle of Jesus as he faces what's coming upon him in the next hours. Guide our thoughts here today so that we would be thinking about things that matter to you and not things that are sort of peripheral. I pray that you would address my heart and the heart of each one here. I pray that you would cultivate in us these remarkable things that we see in Jesus, because, Lord, they are so far from natural for us. They must come from your Spirit. This is our prayer. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.